Valedictory and award function. Couple of announcements to kindly keep your mobile phones on silent mode, please. As you're all aware that since 1969, eminent achievers in business and industry are being honored with the MMA Business Leadership Award, instituted in the memory of Sri S. Anant Ramakrishnan, the founder and past president of MMA. Till now, 18 luminaries of the Indian industry have done award proud by accepting it. Members of MMA, IMA, local management associations, and a cross-section of managers, industrialists, and entrepreneurs from all over India have sent their nominations for the most deserving candidate for this award. Further details on the MMA Amalgamations Business Leadership Award function will be informed to the members shortly. Please log in to the website and the other social media platforms, wherein we will be informing on the date and the venue of the Business Leadership Award function. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the stage is set for the valedictory and awards function. Kindly settle down. Also, the 8th Kevin Kerr MMA Chini Krishnan Innovation Awards will honor entrepreneurs who have embodied the dreamer, innovator, ideator qualities. The mission of this award is to identify and showcase innovative organizations who have introduced breakthrough changes in the Indian context and can become role model for other Indians. The 8th Kevin Kerr MMA Chini Krishnan Innovation Awards 2019 will be presented at the Grand Gala function on Wednesday, 4th of September 2019 at 6 p.m. at Kamaraj Arangam, Chennai. Mr. Harsh Mariwala, Chairman Mariko Limited, has kindly consented to be the chief guest and present the award to the winners and also address on the theme innovation. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very, very warm welcome to the valedictory and award function of the 18th MMA Awards for Managerial Excellence and the 63rd MMA Annual General Meeting. A very warm welcome to our viewers who are watching this program, especially our members who are in our chapters. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the pleasure of inviting the dignitaries to take their place on the dais. Please welcome them with a round of applause. Mr. P.S. Ishwaran, Partner, Deloitte. Mr. A. Venkat Ramani, Senior Vice President, Madras Management Association, Director, India Pistons Limited, and Managing Director, IP Rings Limited. Mr. L. Ramkumar, President, MMA, and Chairman, Shanti Gears Limited. Mr. Pankaj Madan, Deputy Head, India Office and Head Programs, Conrad Adenauer Stiftung. Our distinguished guest for today, Mr. Kamal Bali, President and Managing Director of Volvo Group. Mr. U.D. Chaube, Director General, Standing Conference of Public Enterprises. And Group Captain R. Vijay Kumar, Executive Director, Madras Management Association. Can we have a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, as I welcome the dignitaries on the stage. As customary, we begin this event with the invocation song to invoke the blessings of Lord Shiva. To render the song, may I now invite Ms. Padmaja. I request the audience to kindly rise for the invocation song. Thank you.
Dim dim dimi dimi natana Shiva Tandava keli vilasa Shiva Dim dim dimi dimi natana Shiva Tandava keli vilasa Shiva Leela manusha vesha Shiva Lingodbhavakara Sai Shiva Atma Lingodbhavakara Sai Shiva Sai Shiva Satya Sai Shiva Sai Shiva Satya Sai Shiva Dim Dim Dimi Dimi Natana Shiva Tandava Keli Vilasa Shiva Tandava Keli Vilasa Shiva
Thank you, madam. May I request Mr. Chaube to kindly present a floral bouquet to Ms. Padmaja as a token of appreciation. Thank you, sir. Mr. Ram Kumar is the President of Madras Management Association and Chairman Shanti Gears Limited. I now call upon Mr. Ram Kumar to deliver the welcome address.
Distinguished members on the dais, Mr. Ishwaran of Deloitte, Ram Venkatramani, Senior Vice President, Mr. Chaube, Mr. Kamal Bali, Mr. Pankaj Madan, and Group Captain Vijay Kumar. Distinguished invitees, delegates, past presidents of MMA, managing committee members of MMA, the press and all the others, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to all of you. I am indeed very happy to be here in this particular function, because you know the motive of MMA is to spread the management excellence in this part of the world. As part of this effort, what we do is not only impart management education in terms of certification courses which we do for various levels, we also have experts speaking to us at various points of time. We also have various talks on contemporary topics, especially now that we have started on digitalization and stuff like that. But also, we think it's our duty to recognize and encourage excellence in management as well. Now, there are two purposes. One is recognition and excellence motivates people. And we have many awards for this. For some of you who are familiar with MMA, it may be a repetition, but for the benefit of those who might be here for the first time, we have many awards. One is for the students, actually. We have a very classic Chanakya, the mastermind, which is very much looked forward to by the students with a cash prize of 1 lakh. It's the best management student. We have something like 205,000 students starting, and then we have a lot of filtration going through. Then we have the best MBA student in this part of India. Then we have an award for the best woman manager. We also have an excellent program of honoring innovation along with Kevin Care, Chinnakrishna Innovation Award. MMA and CKR especially personally is involved in this. We do this every year. We find some excellent talent in this. And Managerial Excellence Award is also a very important event on the calendar. Now here, as you know, I don't want to preempt Ishwaran. Ishwaran has been associated with us for many years in this particular thing. And he will explain to all of you the methodology we followed and how we went about the whole thing. Thank you, Ishwaran, for being here. Mr. Chaube has come all the way from Delhi for this purpose. And we really appreciate, sir, your taking time off to be here. And I hope you enjoy the evening. And Mr. Kamal Bali has come down from Bangalore, just could make it in spite of the traffic. In spite of his busy schedule, he's here. A special welcome to him as well. And Mr. Pankaj Madan, they are a constant supporter for us. You all know about the various programs we have done with CAS. These people support us in many, many events and also make us do newer events, like we, this time we did functional governance. It's something very new. It's only MMA did, you know, others would have found it very difficult to do. We got all the various political leaders from different parties on the same platform with a focus only on development and future. So thank you, Pankaj, for being here. He's also come all the way from Delhi to be here. So this Managerial Excellence Award is given to recognize, as I said, and also we have had, for those of you who are present a little earlier, presentations by the winners. The idea is, all of us wonder, you know, what made them get the presentation? So that's one thing. So there is a lot of curiosity. Second is, I think there's a lot of learning one can do in this. What sets them apart? And I think we had some excellent presentations. Some of them are here, Mr. Sundaram, and Mr. Vaidhi Subramaniam, another, Mr. Vaidhi Subramaniam, right? Okay, I suppose I got your name right. And others who are here, our hearty congratulations to the winners and the excellent presentations which they made. And I think there were a lot of questions which, of course, we didn't have time, but I'm sure they will answer this offline. We have this award supported by many organizations, Tata Consultancy Services, IndusInd Bank, Sundaram BNP, Paribas Home Finance, and Deloitte Consultant. We thank them. We welcome their people here to be attending this. As you know, MMA has completed another year here. We have the AGM today, and we settled down in this building. The endeavor is to constantly enhance the brand image of MMA, which is being done ably by our secretariat, Mr. Group Captain Vijay Kumar and his able team, who go about it with, I will say, very quiet confidence. There's no noise, but you know, the number of programs have increased, the quality of programs has increased. Seeing the audience, I'm also very impressed about the number of people and the people coming from various walks of life to this. This itself shows how exactly, you know, we are progressing. Once again, thank you all for being here, and I'm sure you're going to have an excellent evening. And once again, welcome you all for this function. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Conrad Adenauer Stiftung has been partner with MMA for the last so many years, promoting entrepreneurial development program. We are delighted to have with us Mr. Pankaj Madan, who is the Deputy Head India Office and Head Programs Conrad Adenauer Stiftung, who has come all the way from Delhi. I now invite Mr. Pankaj to offer his felicitations on this great occasion.
Thank you, my friend, and good evening to everybody. Dr. Chaube, Mr. Kamal Bali, President Ram Kumar, Mr. Subramaniam, my friend Group Captain, and of course the incoming President, Mr. A. Venkatramani. Well, we spent an afternoon today not just seeing excellence being awarded, and also in the field of education, which was really inspiring. Also inspiring was the MSME performance in aerospace. And then TI industry also came up with some great stuff. No, it really is a great occasion to be here. Unfortunately, last year we had to miss that because we had our own president from Germany coming here of our foundation. But today, let me extend a very warm and hearty welcome to all of you who have gathered here today for this AGM of MMA. Today, I was asked to deliver a felicitatory speech towards the Madras Management Association on behalf of the Konrad Adenauer Foundation and Mr. Peter Rimmele, the resident representative to India, but who could not make it here as he's in Germany. But he made it a point to call, especially today in the afternoon, to convey his regards to the august audience here and to the distinguished guests. I see many old friends, but I also see many new ones too. So allow me to kind of give you a quick intro of the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, which is a German political foundation headquartered in Berlin with over 100 country offices, active in more than 100 countries, 20 offices in the Asian region to have regional programs. The aim of the foundation is to foster peace and freedom. CAS encourages a continuous dialogue at the national and international levels, as well as on the exchange between topics of security policy, economic issues, rule of law, social and political change, while stressing also on exchange between cultures and religions. In this regard, it is our goal to promote the values of democracy, social market economy, that is a market system with a humane face, or Mr. Narayan Murthy of Infosys said, compassionate capitalism and the rule of law. Last year, we celebrated our 50th anniversary of being active in India, and we couldn't have operated in India so successfully in the last decades without the support of our long-standing partners, especially the Madras Management Association. A fountainhead of excellence indeed. Excellence is a continuous process and not an accident, said President Abdul Kalam. The partnership with Madras Management Association dates back, let me get this in Tamil, 30 years, yeah, and has put forth a wide range of events under the leadership of first Colonel Hariharan, then Major Lakshmanan, and now Group Captain Vijay Kumar, under the vibrant guidance of the Management Committee of the MMA and the Presidium. Personally, I can say that the relationship between the two organizations has always been characterized by mutual respect and admiration. This has been visible through all kinds of interactions, be it the communication during the preparations of a conference or an event where there have been, you know, always last minute issues or problems at the venue. My colleagues and I personally have really enjoyed working, co-organizing events with MMA, as we know of the very high standards of diligence and work ethic. You know, but at this juncture, some two or three personal stories with MMA, very brief ones, or at least the mention. One person was Group Captain Vijay Kumar's predecessor, who is no more with us, Major Lakshmanan, also a very vibrant person. And I remember in November about 2004 or 2005, there was this event that was organized as a regional conclave at the Tidal Park. And that day, it was raining so badly, the Tidal Park really deserved the name that day, because there is a slope going down and then you go up. So that V was totally covered with water, and as we tried to enter with an ambassador, the water seeped in from the door, the crack between the door and the floor. So we had to go back. And Major Lakshmanan was like rolled up his trousers and commissioned a hire vehicle and said, come on. And there were 200 people coming there, and he personally made sure that everybody got in. So this is the kind of, you know, commitment to work. Then I must remember a very gentle person, Pandey Rajan. Ever ready with a smile, ever ready with, you know, that attitude of can be done. And we have again lost him very, I think, in the near past. I just wanted to mention him. But now, ladies and gentlemen, the building that you sit in, this whole new setup, it's a testament to the abilities of Bruce Vijay Kumar. So I can tell you, this is only one of his accomplishments. He has established new standards. And as far as we are concerned, he's our go-to man for anything to be done in South India. So it's a characteristic of MMA to stay on top of what's happening in the world in order to develop new ideas, visions that will boost the member organization's abilities, meaning staying ahead of the curve, to have a vision beyond the curve and see what will be the need of the future. No wonder winning the IMA Best Local Awards has become a habit. Please give it to the Indian cricket team too. Maybe they bring back the World Cup. Therefore, MMA has never shied away from organizing events that reach beyond the scope of management trainings. And just to mention a few, one President Ramkumar mentioned just now, but blue economy, India's political economy, the conference of topics such as the global maritime order, national security, under the brand name MMA Cast, national and regional conclaves. I mean, what is it that MMA can't do? It is the curious mind and the constant quest for knowledge of the MMA staff that makes the organization an outstanding one. Not only do they teach the abilities of managerial excellence and leadership, they live by these values. It's a way of life. MMA has been a partner that we can always count on and has been crucial for our outreach in South India. So, for us, not MMA is not just a partner in excellence, but it's an imparter of excellence to us even. Azim Premji has remarked that excellence is a great starting point for any new organization, but also for others, it's an unending journey. That means there's always a quest for perfection. Excellence endures and sustains. It goes beyond motivation into the realms of inspiration. May the MMA continue to inspire all of us in times to come. I salute MMA. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pankaj, for that very inspiring thoughts. Ladies and gentlemen, MMA comes out with an eagerly awaited news magazine amongst the management fraternity, Business Mandate. The in-house magazine of MMA, Business Mandate, has a readership of over 45,000 who feature among the leading business groups in South India and are also made up of dynamic medium-scale companies as well as reputed professionals from all walks of industry. Other than MMA members, business mandate is circulated to notable opinion makers, industry leaders, senior government officials, multinational group heads, management students, and a host of distinguished personalities. In addition, e-copy of the business mandate is also circulated among large number of management professionals and management students in the country. Since the inception of the MMA Awards for Managerial Excellence in 2002, MMA has been bringing out a special issue of the business mandate on managerial excellence with the participation of the awardees. In this issue, MMA aims at showcasing the journey towards managerial excellence of these organizations in order for other members to learn from. On the occasion of the 18th MMA Awards for Managerial Excellence 2019 and the MMA AGM, we have brought out a special issue of the magazine consisting of interesting articles for the benefit of our readers. I now request our distinguished guests, Mr. Chaube, Director General, Standing Conference of Public Services, to kindly step forward and release the special issue of the business mandate and request him to hand over the first copy to Mr. Kamal Bali. Thank you, sir. Mr. Kamal Bali joined the Volvo Group in India in April 2014 as Managing Director and a board member of the company. With an illustrious career spanning over four decades, predominantly in the automotive industry, Mr. Kamal has worked for well-known Indian brands and established multinational corporations in India. He has had an insightful experience in the functional areas of sales, marketing, and supply chain before taking over P&L responsibilities in the year 2002. Mr. Kamal is a thought leader and an active speaker in the national and international forums. Ladies and gentlemen, I now present to you Mr. Kamal Bali to deliver the keynote address.
Gentlemen on the dais, my dear friend Mr. Raju, ladies and gentlemen, it's indeed a pleasure and a great honor for me to be here in the company of such a distinguished gathering and of an institution like MMA. I'm truly honored and privileged to be here this evening. Gentlemen and ladies, we are living in very interesting times. Times where hashtags are used to convey opinions. Likes are used to convey approvals or validations, and smileys are used to communicate generally with each other. So when I came here, I was thinking, what topic should I speak on? What should be the theme of what I should share my perspective on? So I thought a very topical theme today is, how do we build India, and how do we build India with innovation and entrepreneurship at its heart? I thought this would be a very relevant topic, especially when an institution like MMA can play a very major role in making that happen. So over the next 20 minutes, I will try to share my perspective of what is the operating environment around us today, what are the changes happening in the world, in the world of business and commerce, and even the societal world as such. What are the changes happening, and what lies in store for India of the future? And how shall we build an India of our dreams? Especially with focus on innovation and entrepreneurship. So we know we are all living in a VUCA world, a world which is marked by volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity. This is the world where we are living in. But the future clearly belongs to a highly integrated, connected, and an automated world. That's the bottom line, and that's the reality on ground. Today, more and more customers and consumers are wanting smart solutions delivered in a smart way. They do not want solutions the way or products as they were served earlier. As we all know, today, India is a land of a billion opportunities, but equally eye-watering challenges like inequities of health, gender, education, rural distress. But the good news is that the young India is daring to dream, daring to act, and solve some of the societal problems which we had never imagined earlier in a very, very different way. But let me step back just about 40 years ago. In the year 1978, both India and China were almost at the same level in terms of the economic size. Especially the year 1978, we were exactly same numbers. But over the last 40 years, China grew at a nominal expansion CAGR of about 12% per annum, constantly for 40 years, which means the GDP growth must have been 7 to 8% on an average, if nominal growth expansion was 12%, which is 50% more than what India grew at. India grew at about 8% nominal in the last 40 years, which may have translated to about 4 to 5% of, maybe 4% of GDP growth, real growth. So the key point here is, while we were in the world of fiats and ambassadors, they really leapfrogged. Not only leapfrogged, they pole vaulted, and they became 24% of global manufacturing. Whereas we are today at 3% of, so which means that we are punching much below our weight. We are 16% of the global population, but just about 3% of the global manufacturing. So we're punching much below our weight. So I think this is a challenge, and that is why if you look at the level of penetration, if you look at our per capita GDP, we are just about $2,000 per person per annum, whereas China is 10,000. China is not a benchmark, but I'm just trying to bring a reference to China for a different purpose. For a purpose because they are similar size in terms of population, they're an Asian country, we come from similar, not very different ethnicities, okay? It may be different, but they are not in the Western part of the world. So I think what they have done in a different way is possible for India in a very, very smart and a better way. So, therefore, it's clear that there is abundant scope for India because we are punching much below our weight. We have lots of ground to cover in a very, very quick time. Today, if you look at, we are the fifth largest economy. As we speak, we are the fifth largest economy. I mean, some people say sixth, but I believe we have become already $2.9 trillion USD, whereas UK is about 2.8. So we have crossed UK. We will, by another few years, we will become the third largest after crossing Germany and Japan, and we will be third to US and China. We are a very fast growing middle class, and I think this is one of our biggest demand drivers for India. We used to be only 11% of our population in 2009 used to be in the middle class category. Middle class is defined as people drawing between 2 lakhs to 5 lakhs per annum, just for the purpose of this. Today, 33% of our population lies there. So I think that's a huge, huge change which is happening. We have roughly, if you look at the ease of doing business, we have jumped to 77 out in 2018 from 140th position in 2015. 400 new airports have to be redeveloped. 35 logistics parks are being built. 40 kilometers per road is the target. Today we are at about 30 kilometers per day, and it used to be just about 8 kilometers per day. And 5 industrial corridors are being developed. So some things are happening. Some things are happening on ground. A lot of structural reforms have taken place. GST has taken place. But I think the good news is that it's the innovators and the entrepreneurs which are going to really bring the new game. The paradigm shift is going to happen like that. Not in this way, not in the incremental way. We have to go the exponential way. And that is what is happening. So, what are the challenges these entrepreneurs are facing? I think they are facing 5 or 6 challenges which we have to help them with. Number one, they're having sectoral challenge. Which sector of the economy they are operating, their challenges related to the sector. The next is life stage challenges. Whether they are in the growing up stage, the startup, the growing up, the maturity, the aging stage. So all those challenges, the different sorts of challenges. The third one is macroeconomic challenges, functional challenges, geopolitical challenges. So number of challenges and how do we get the better? Because of paucity of time, I cannot go into the detail of these challenges, but maybe at a later date, we can have a session on some of these where we can support. But the real thing is that the kind of changes which are sweeping our world are going to completely redefine the way we work. So what are these changes? Technological shifts which are happening at a breakneck speed. Changing business models. People are doing business from asset-led models to asset-light models. We have so many examples of Airbnbs and the Ubers of the world. Idea-led models, asset-light. We have changing demographics. The millennials are taking center stage in organizations. Their way of working is very, very different from my generation. They have very small span of attention. They want instant gratification. They want to be engaged all the time. They want challenges all the time. They don't love 9-to-5 sort of a job. Very different sort of a thing which is happening. Then there are geopolitical challenges. Now, what does this mean to us? This means there are 2 major things which are happening in this world, and especially in India, that there is a change in the demand for talent and there is a change in the supply of talent. What is the change in demand for talent? Whatever talent you need has to be digitally and technologically equipped, number one. And that talent must also know how to create business value or value for the customer in a different way. So that's the new set of skills which you will need. And in terms of supply for talent, we have already discussed their work-life balance, their cultural upbringing is very, very different. So, are we future ready? To understand if we are future ready, we must understand what the future is going to be. So I believe it's very difficult to predict the future, but I can tell you with fair degree of certainty that our future will be shaped by 5 things. The number one is digitalization. There will be about 50 billion connected vehicles by the year 2025. Just to give you an example. 50 billion connected devices, connected vehicles by the year 2025. So you can imagine, I don't even need to talk about that. The second change, which is the second mega trend, which will define our future, is rapid urbanization. In the year 1950, only 30% of the world lived in cities. By 2050, 70% of the world will live in cities. Which means in a country like India, between 2010 to 2050, in the 40 years period, we will add 49 crore people from rural India into urban India. 49 crore people. What does this mean? This means that we will create a country which is 1.5 times size of America. Imagine the implications, imagine the opportunities on health, on education, on housing, on sanitation, on mobility. And this is real. This is not academic. This is not some projection. This is happening on ground. We are not even realizing it. So that's the second major shift of rapid urbanization. The third is growing need for sustainability. Sustainability used to be a lip service so far, but sustainability is becoming real. When I say sustainability, I mean that whatever we do or whatever we shall do has to pass a filter of 3 tests. First, are we economically viable? Whatever we bring has to be smart and economically viable. Number two, it has to be socially inclusive, which means it cannot touch just the creamy layer. It has to touch the entire pyramid. It has to be inclusive. And third, it has to be environmentally friendly. You cannot, you can bring the best product, but if it is not environmentally friendly, it will not find any audience at all. So that's the third change, which is growing need for sustainability. The fourth mega trend is a bad news for many companies, is that customers do not want products anymore. They want solutions. They want solutions and outcomes. What does this mean? That no company can provide that 100% 360 degree solution to the customer on its own. Therefore, companies will have to collaborate, which means the arrogance of large companies will be demolished, which means the startups, the younger companies, the younger people who can be very agile can be part of the whole game. So collaboration is the fourth element. And the fifth element of the future is the new skills. And this is very scary. 48% of the skills which we have today will become redundant in another 6 to 7 years. Today's skills. And the skills which will be required 10 years from now, probably many of them don't even exist today. Which means we will have to find what are the new skills, and then we will have to train on the fly to be able to. So these five things, five major mega trends which we have researched, is really going to define how, what are the opportunities in the place. What does this mean? What does this mean to the companies and to institutions? Which means that there'll be a fluid sense of what lies inside the company, what lies outside the company. Who's my employee? Who's my supplier? Who's my partner? It will be very, very fluid. So therefore, all the HR policies will have to be thrown out of the window. The existing HR policies and procedures, the SOPs, so to say, and we are throwing them out, mind you. Because you will be driven by principles. You will have, organizations will have to define guiding principles and not guiding rules. Rules will be decided by the individual himself or herself. You will only have to tell that these are the values, this is the way we operate, under certain circumstances, take decision based on these factors. And this is the way the organization. So HR will be completely transformed. HR policy. So I think that's the first thing. Speed and agility is going to be the key. Earlier, scale used to be the key. Well, I'm Volvo. I'm a $50 billion company. Who cares? Tomorrow, a $1 million small startup can completely disrupt you. So it's the speed and not the scale which will matter. The third thing is, as I told, everything will have to be designed around people. Focus and design around people. And that's going to be the key. And just to share a few opportunities arising out of, from India perspective, I've just listed 5 or 6 opportunities as India moves forward. And these are based on compelling imperatives for India or the opportunities for India. Either the imperative or the opportunity. Anything which you do has to either fulfill some burning need, pain point, or it fulfills certain opportunities, gaps existing which nobody is fulfilling. So the first one is education. Education is going to be one of the key areas where you all can think of, and I think MMA is very, very well equipped. How to keep children beyond 7 years in school is a huge challenge for India. So many children in India do not stay in school beyond 7 years. Second, agriculture. 60% of our population is dependent on agriculture. We have to bring this number down to 30%. Why? Because 60% people contribute to 15% of GDP, whereas the balance 40% people contribute to 85% of GDP. And that is where the inequity starts. So 30% population has to deliver, instead of currently 3 tons per hectare, they have to deliver 7 tons per hectare, which means double whammy. We will half the number of people in agriculture, and we will double the agriculture output. So that's how India, and this is all possible. Farm to fork revolution is possible, and this is happening. Another one is digital connectivity. Many of you are doing nothing new. The fourth one, which is very favorite of mine, is manufacturing. Unfortunately, in India, manufacturing is only 16% of our GDP. All major countries which have grown well in the last 30, 40 years, it's manufacturing which have anchored them. And manufacturing to their GDP has been between 22% to 30%. Whether you take Korea, China, Germany, any of these countries, Japan, 30% on an average is manufacturing GDP. We have only 16%, and we are stuck at 16% since 1991. And manufacturing, why manufacturing? Not because I'm in love with manufacturing. Because manufacturing has a multiplier effect. One job in manufacturing leads to 2.5 jobs in upstream and downstream. So that's something very critical. The next one is organized retail. Organized retail is only 12% today of the total retail. We can easily go up to 50%. The next one is urbanization, which you all know. What are the possibilities? And the last one is logistics. This is where India's pain point. India's logistics cost is 14% of our GDP, which means that whereas global average is 8%, which means on an average, we waste 6% of our GDP, which is if it is $3 trillion, 6% of that is close to, I don't know how much, to $300-400 billion. This can fulfill the healthcare needs of our entire nation if we can stop this waste. So we, as Volvo, we have offered to Niti Aayog that we will work with them and do a demo to show that we can reduce the logistics cost by 50%. There are ways and means to do that. So these are the opportunity areas, and this only through innovation and through critical thinking and thinking out of the box is very, very important. So what does this mean to organizations? Organizations cannot have those organization structure. There is a managing director, then there is a CEO, COO, and HR head, this head. Structures will have to take the shape of amoeba. Structures will have to be as the customers want, as the business wants. You will not have those standard organization structures. So I think this is something, and boundaries between inside and outside will be very, very blurred. Hierarchy will be from hierarchical structure to a very, very fluid structure. And culture, as you all know, every organization has two steering systems, a culture and a structure. We always, if something went wrong, we always tweak the structure. Okay, sack this guy, get this guy. Okay, after 3 years, same old results, more of the same, yeah? So it doesn't work. So the reason is, that is the culture which we have to tweak, is the culture which we have to change. And culture is not easy. Culture eats strategy, eats breakfast, strategy for breakfast. I mean, as there is a saying. So I think culture is living that life inside out every day, setting those examples, setting those role models. Culture is what we reward. Culture is what we do not like. What behaviors are rewarded and what behaviors are not liked inside the company. So I think this is something very important. Performance appraisal will not be annual. Performance appraisal will be every day, will be perpetual. So this is the way, and it's a huge mindset change for a guy like me, a 60-year-old guy who was taught by HR some other practices. So it's a shock, but I'm enjoying this shock because it's fun to work these youngsters. It's fun to work these 23 and 24-year-olds because they teach you a lot. And what you can do, you can also play a very, very interesting role. You can bring your gray hair to some good use. Really, really with these youngsters, it's a lethal combination. So I think this is something. So just to close my thing, I hope I have not taken too long. Yeah, I'll take just two, three minutes to close. Just to say, what is the road to success then? And the road to success for India is very, very clearly ROAD. R stands for reset our assumptions. First is reset our assumptions. It is not the same old India. It is not the same old world. We have to get over our stereotypes that girls are meant to do this and boys are meant to do this. I mean, all those stereotypes we'll have to throw. This is the way HR works. This is the way organization policy is. We have to follow the policy. No, we don't have to follow the policy. We have to follow to add business value, to add value to our customers' business. As long as we are doing that, we will succeed. Second is O, organize for the future. Don't organize for today. Because today is just past. As we speak, it's gone. It's the tomorrow. And the future is what I shared with you, the 5 points of future. Develop fluid structures, amoeba kind of structures. Be flexible, be adaptive. The third word in the third alphabet in road is A. Is advanced with agility. You have to be very, very fleet-footed, agile, and be ready for, you can't be carrying some past baggage. And the last one is D. D means digitalize your business. Digitalize whatever you do, because without that, there is no future. That's very, very clear. So, and just to take one example of Volvo. In Volvo, we have created a place called Camp X. Just to give shape to what I taught, we have created a place called Camp X in Gothenburg. And if everything goes successful, we will be replicating that in Bangalore. It's a place of 1 lakh square feet. About 400 people work there. I will tell you which kind of people work there. We have cloud computing. We have workshop, lab, and everything inside that 1 lakh square feet area. The kind of people who work there are our employees. Out of 400 people, about 100 are our employees. There are government regulators. There are our customers. There are our customers' customers. There are our suppliers. There are startups, young boys and girls. They all work. 400 people work. We define certain problems and challenges. Everybody works together to solve those challenges. There are no rules. There are only principles. So we work there, and it's been now 2 months. It's showing phenomenal results. We had 100 people picked up from the organization of 1 lakh people. Now we have applications from 10,000 more boys and girls who want to be part of that. It's a very, very different ball game, and it's giving us mind-boggling results. We are working like a small company, very, very agile, very, very quick to act. So I think this is going to be the way. And for Volvo, we are working at 3 levels. One is at production and processes, at factory, that is first level. Other is the vehicle level. How do we automate the vehicle? How do we make it autonomous? And the third level is, how does vehicle behave and interact with the outside world, the outside traffic, and how can it be completely following the lanes and other things on its own? So I think with this, if we do that, I think we will have an India. The idea of that India would be a strong economy, which is built through entrepreneurship and innovation. B, transparency in public life. I think this is going to be very important, because transparency leads to trust and collaboration. If you're not transparent, you cannot have trust and collaboration. And without that, this whole concept will not work. The third is social and gender equity. You cannot ignore the women in our country. 50% of the population, if it is not participating in the game plan of India, India cannot be a superpower. So this is the third thing. The fourth is excellence in whatever we do. Excellence in the delivered quality. Now this is something very interesting for me, which as an Indian I found very funny. When I go to Sweden, out of the 2 hours board meeting, we have number of agenda, 1 hour is spent on quality. 1 hour is spent on quality, the age-old world. The only thing which is constant is quality. Everything else is changed. All agenda has changed, only quality is discussed. Even though we know we have amongst the best in the world in terms of our quality, but quality is discussed. The chairman of the board discusses quality for 1 hour. So I think that's something that will never be out of your agenda. The fifth is sustainable development. We have talked of physical, digital, and environment, all this. And last but not the least, sixth point is national pride, which is something which we lack a lot. I think we should be proud Indians. When we walk, we should walk with our head high, because I have seen that Indians are no less than anyone. In fact, better than most. And I think we need to build that brand, and that's how we can build an India with a difference. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Kamal, for that very insightful and very, very inspiring address. Mr. P.S. Ishwaran is the partner with Deloitte and has over 2 decades of years of experience in industry and consulting experience. May I now call upon Mr. Ishwaran to brief us on the MMA Managerial Excellence Award process.
Distinguished guests on the dais, ladies and gentlemen. As always, it's a pleasure for us to be associated with MMA, and you had all the reasons so far as to why it's one of the best associations in India. I think just to take a step back, till about the previous year, the process was that we used to have nominations, self-nominations by companies, and we used to have a balanced model of an initial shortlist and then a final jury meeting for us to decide the winners. Now this year, MMA and their committee have taken a different view. And I think what it has done is that you have over 125 nominations from whom to choose from for the four. And what it meant is that people could nominate others in addition to self-nomination. So you had across four categories, manufacturing, SME, education, and services, we had over 125 nominations to choose from. So pretty tough over a short deadline, but I think worked pretty well. And therefore, I think that was possibly one of the best things. You had a lot of participation. And therefore, you also had companies which had initially not participated being in front. So we had an initial shortlist coming out through the MMA subcommittee, and that reduced it to a much smaller set of roughly about 10% of people who had applied. So 90% of them could not pass through the filters and then was presented to the jury. So the jury had a pretty tough act. Mr. Swami, under your leadership, many thanks for bearing with us with a lot of analysis. And I think the jury had a lot of views around how we should look at it. And many thanks to them for pushing us back a number of times. And we finally were able to look at possibly the four who really were the best of the best. So many congratulations to the winners. And I think this year has been an exception on that we had a high number of applications to choose from and a fairly rigorous process, as always, for us to work on. So thank you so much, and best wishes to everyone.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we now come to the most awaited moment, the presentation of the awards. May I now call upon Group Captain Vijay Kumar to announce the awards.
Thank you, Prakash. MMA has always promoted sound management knowledge, experience, and ideas in various disciplines, with a wish to award recognition in every year to excellence in managerial thinking, action, and demonstrable results of companies and institutions who have the corporate registered office within the southern state of India. MMA instituted this award of managerial excellence in the year 2002. The focus of the award is overall managerial excellence rather than some of the functional areas of excellence. Shortly, you will see your audiovisual presentation about each of the companies. You'll have more experience. Now, the award is supported by Sundaram PNB Paribas, Home Finance, Indus In Bank, Tata Consultancy Services, and Deloitte Consultant. We are indeed grateful to them. But for their support, I don't think we'll be able to organize such a great event for the benefit of our members. May I now request our distinguished guest, Mr. Kamal Bali, President and Managing Director of Volvo Group, and Mr. Dr. Chube, Director, General Standing Conference of Public Enterprises, Scope, from New Delhi, to step forward and give away the 18th MMA Award for Managerial Excellence for the year. Now you can go for the audio.
May I request Mr. Velayan, Managing Director, Tube Investments of India Limited.
Velayan, not something. Oh, from station.
Mr. Selvakumar, representing...
I'm just representing Mr. Velan. He just stepped out. He had a flight to catch. I'm Selvakumar. I manage HR for Cube Investments of India Limited.
Thank you, sir. Can we have the next AV, please? Request Mr. Y.S. Chakravarti, Chief Operating Officer, Sri Ram City Union Finance Limited, to kindly come onto the stage to receive the award. Can we have a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? Services sector, Sri Ram City Union Finance Limited. Thank you, sir. We have the next AV on the SME sector. I request Mr. Sundaram, Managing Director, Aerospace Engineers Private Limited, to receive the award. Thank you, sir. We now have the next AV on educational institution. Dr. S. Vaidyasubramaniam, Vice Chancellor, Shastra Deemed University, receiving the award. Ladies and gentlemen, this year the jury has recommended, in addition to the four awards, a special recognition award and certificate of merit to Skillvery Training Solutions Private Limited under SMEs category for innovative practices adopted by them in quality delivery of practical vocational skill training. May I now request Mr. Kannan Lakshminarayanan, Co-Founder, Director, Skillvery Training Solutions Private Limited, and Mr. C. Shivakumar, Director, Skillvery, to kindly come onto the stage to receive the award. I request all the winners, the four winners, to kindly join the dignitaries on the stage for a group photograph. I request the winners to please come with the trophy.
I just wanted to just share that this is like, a second coming of my first relationship with MMA. I was working for Siemens in 1996. I was part of the winning team of the Young Manager competition that MMA had. Thank you.
Thank you to the dignitaries on the dais, and many congratulations to the winners. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. U.D. Chaube is presently the Director General of Standing Conference of Public Enterprises. Dr. Chaube has more than 40 years of rich experience in management, energy, oil and gas, and economic issues dealt in state-owned enterprises. Dr. Chaube is actively associated with the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, particularly Asia Network on Corporate Governance of State-Owned Enterprises. I now invite Dr. Chaube to deliver the valedictory address.
Good evening, everybody. Very distinguished persons sitting on the dais, off the dais too. Participants, ladies and gentlemen. As Pakistan inning ends at 315, I start my talk on managerial effectiveness, because constantly I was looking at the score in my mobile phone. I am really privileged, and it is a pleasure pride too for me to have been invited by MMA to speak something on this August gathering. I compliment MMA because I must have visited so many management associations in a number of states, and this is a unique experience the way you have been conducting, and it is a real compliment to all the office bearers, participants, members for this type of management. Well, you know, I belong to public sector enterprises, and when I was introduced as 40 years, it appears that I was underrated. I have now 46 years of public sector experience. And this was more than enough to become more lethargic and inefficient because of having served in public sector enterprises for such a long years, as we have been criticized for being a public sector. We are immune to that. We do not take care of such criticism. And therefore, I will devote 2-3 minutes on public sectors, because SCOPE is a public sector body. It is an apex body to provide excellence in public sector enterprises. And they are providing my salary, so I have to justify my existence there. There are 335 central public sector enterprises in India, having an investment of around 13 lakhs crore by Government of India. And on this, 23 lakhs crore is the turnover, which is around 14% of the Indian GDP. The net profit of all the public sector enterprises is around 1,50,000 crores. And after meeting the 30,000, compensating the 30,000 for loss-making companies, the net is 1,28,000 crores, which public sector enterprises are earning every year. Not only that, they are paying over 3,50,000 crores towards government exchequers in terms of taxes, duties, dividend. So in no way you can rate it inferior to anybody, particularly when the best practices in corporate governance is being practiced by public sector enterprises. The only aspect for which public sector enterprises have been accused and underrated is the governance part, particularly because independent directors are not to the extent required. This is what. But if you see the last 6 months, including large many as independent directors, you will not have that regret. And more so, public sectors are not authorized to make appointment of independent directors to the government. So the public sector are not responsible for that. Leaving aside this, I will tell that the best confidence of the investors are there in public sector enterprises. As you could have seen the issues from ONGC or Coal India Limited, which was the world's largest record, EIL and all that. So public and investors' confidence are therein. And 50 PSU, which have been listed, is hardly 5%. But they command a market capitalization of almost 12% as of yesterday. About 10, a little over 10 lakhs employees are there in public sector enterprises. So this is in a nutshell public sector. But I know I have to speak something on managerial excellence. When it comes to managerial excellence side, I go back to more than 2,000 years back, when Socrates told that a lion leading a bunch of donkeys will always defeat a donkey leading a bunch of lions. And there lies the leadership quality which is responsible for managerial effectiveness in everywhere, be it enterprise or be it any area. But coming to, because 2,000 years and plus is a long and old year, today what is happening that there is a complete change in mindset, complete change in environment, and there is a paradigm shift in the managerial thinking as such. What is happening that what was unusual yesterday has become usual today. And again, what is usual today will become unusual tomorrow. This is where a fast change is taking place all over the world in the entrepreneurial side. And we have seen that governance part has become the key in all the enterprises to bring the better excellence in the management side. Management, as you know, it is based on locus standi has been transparency, trust, responsiveness, accountability, ethics, integrity, openness, and all that. So this has become rather a key factor for bringing excellence in management side. And sometimes we feel that this is essential ingredient, giving return sometimes more than the patent or technology as such. Now, how do we evaluate the excellence in an enterprise? If the customers are satisfied, we say yes. If the suppliers are happy, we say yes, this is a good governance. If the investors are willing to invest further, we say yes, it is a good governance, it is excellence in management, right? If the employees are motivated, we say that yes, it is so. If the government is confident in you, has confidence in you, then we say that yes, you have a managerial excellence. If employees at large are feeling uplifted, CSR side, we say that it is managerial excellence. If environment is protected, we say yes. But what is happening that every enterprise, every stakeholder is knowing that this is, they have to do. So time has come when some extra mile is being looked into from the management manager side. Unless you provide the extra mile, you have no locus standi today. Therefore, stakeholders are looking for something beyond all this. And that is something like intangible qualities, intangible elements to bring managerial effectiveness. Because stakeholders, particularly equity holders, shareholders, they are knowing the how best you can apply the jugglery of accounting system to inflate the profit. When you come out with a very good number in the annual account number, which you publish year to year as an enterprise. They also know that you are concealing the liabilities when you are announcing the number. And therefore, they are not dazzled by the number which you reflect as a profit or something like that. Today, stakeholders' expectation has gone that high. And they are looking for intangible benefits like CSR activity, like your openness, like your transparency, like your ethical consideration, like your cultural aspect, which Mr. Bali highlighted, that how corporate culture you have built. All that has become very important today to bring managerial excellence. Therefore, companies have been looking for some innovative way of thinking, research and development, so that they come out with something more than what others are thinking, based on their innovation and research activity. The agile way, which Mr. Bali highlighted, has taken place like anything, and all the enterprises are looking into it to bring more effectiveness on that. And what is happening that challenges has multiplied like anything. Some of it was highlighted in that keynote address. Like the, as I consider the best and the biggest challenge today is managing the globalization. Because today what has happened that entire world has become rather a village sort of thing, because what is happening in one corner of the world is known to other side of the remote side of the world. And that has led to the enhancement of expectations in the stakeholders. Like people in, say, Neyveli or Narsapur or Kodulur or Pumpuha know that what is the standard of living in New York, thanks to internet. The boom in internet also came at the time when we opened the economy for, and we liberalized that open market. So one of the best part, I will say best part, that expectation has gone very high in the stakeholders. And if enterprises have enhanced it, we compliment to them that yes, they are enhancing the expectation of the stakeholders. And if you are not able to take care of the stakeholders, then you are likely to become extinct in due course of time, like a dinosaur. And therefore, the managerial effectiveness for the long term, on the long term basis, sustained basis, you have to take care of something which is not only business, because business of doing business has not remained business alone. It is something beyond business, and that is corporate social responsibility. The challenge of a consistent corporate culture has become very important. And your culture is having impact on the stakeholders. Like, for example, the culture of, say, I should not criticize the different departments, like if I name PWD, police, Food Corporation of India, you have certain image which is being formed in your mind. If I say Tata's, you have certain brand image which is being formed. And you must have seen in this magazine which was just now released, how they have built up the corporate culture in Tata. There is a good description of that. I was just reading that. Another challenge is the challenge of change itself. Challenge of managing change. Churchill once told that to be successful, one has to change. And to be perfect, one has to change often. And as the things are changing every day, the corporate people have to change according to that. If you do not change, you become a part of only history. Others will change and they will succeed. Like that, there are so many changes with time which has come. Challenge of managing the knowledge worker. In any organization, hardly 20% of the employees are not white, but gold color workers. They are in minority, but their ideas are in majority. If that is implemented, company gets returned. You will be surprised to know that Colgate Palmolive, the Colgate toothpaste, few years back, a new batch joined Colgate. And one of the new employees told that I can increase the turnover by 25% of Colgate toothpaste. Everybody laughed at how. And he told, I can't tell it to anybody else. I will tell it to only the chairman. Chairman gave him time, 5 minutes time, and he told, no, you do not do anything. You just increase the nozzle of the toothpaste tube and also add a little 2-3% water. And turnover increased by more than 25%. The fellow is now vice president. So you can imagine how simple it was, a mind beyond the box he thought. And now he may be one day heading the entire group. So this is where the thinking process is required. And such knowledge workers must be encouraged. That leads to speak something on motivation. Because they need motivation. If you do not motivate them, then they will leave the organization. And motivation, incidentally, Edmund Burke told that you can buy 8 hours duty. You can also buy some muscle power, but you cannot buy motivation. Motivation will come when you recognize the job. Motivation will come when you have a capacity building for such workers to update on daily, monthly, yearly basis. And there is a job satisfaction. These are the non-monetary motivational things. And that has become very essential these days to employees of the organization. Because gone are our days. When we had joined the public sector, or maybe private sector also, people must be thinking on that line, that we consider the company as mother who is feeding bread and butter and everything. Today it is not there. Employees are not loyal to that. They are loyal to skill development, they are loyal to recognition of job and all that.
Now, since time is very short, so I will just touch
other challenges which are there,
like
challenge of leadership development and succession planning, particularly in public sector. This is a weak part,
I must confess.
Then challenge of managing workforce diversity, because what is happening that these days something is innovated in one country that becomes a product manufactured in another country, accessories come from the third country, combination of all this come in another country and is marketed all over the world. This is where different cultures are amalgamated. So one has to manage the different cultures to bring the real managerial excellence. My friend, I think I have exceeded my time. So otherwise I will go on speaking like this. So sometime else we will meet again. Lastly, I will tell that, and without that it will be incomplete, that I am really amazed with the type of functioning that MMA has. And I will tell that Scope is ready to collaborate, even sign an MOU with you to bring capacity building, because Scope has an academy, Scope Academy of Public Sectors, where we impart training to public sector enterprises particularly. It is open to others also. So we can join hand, and neither Delhi is far off, nor Chennai is far off. So we can take up this, and my doors are open to all of you. Thank you very much for giving this.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for sharing your thoughts. May I now request Mr. Ram Kumar, our President, Madras Management Association, to kindly present mementos to our distinguished guests, to Dr. Chaube and Mr. Kamal Bali. Thank you for having accepted our invitation to be part of this award function. I request Mr. Ram Kumar to also present a memento to Mr. Pankaj Madan. Thank you, Pankaj, for being such a great supporter to MMA. And also to Mr. P.S. Ishwaran. Yes, sir. I now request Mr. A. Venkatramani, Senior Vice President, Madras Management Association, to kindly deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks. Mr. Pankaj Malan, the Conrad Adenauer Foundation has been a great supporter of the MMA, and we look forward to continuing and growing this relationship in the years to come. Thank you very much for sparing your time, sir. Mr. Bali, thank you so much for such an inspiring talk. It was filled with facts and the way you so eloquently told us about the challenges that India is facing, companies are facing, the opportunities that exist, and how we, using innovation and entrepreneurship, can capitalize on this was very eye-opening for all of us, and I'm sure the audience enjoyed it, as did I. Dr. Chaube, sir, thank you so much for your overview on PSUs, their contribution to the Exchequer, and we are all confident that managerial excellence under your leadership will continue to flourish in our public sector enterprises. I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate the winners of the 18th MMA Award for Managerial Excellence, Tube Investments, Sriram City Union Finance, the Salem Aeropark, and Shastra University. Congratulations to all of you again. This award was also obviously made possible by our illustrious jury, who spared their valuable time in making these critical selections. Mr. Srinivasan Swami, Mr. Shankar, Mr. Ramaraj, Mr. Anuj Kumar, Mr. B. Srinivas, thank you all very much. Once again, thanks to our sponsors, without whom this event would not have been possible: Tata Consultancy, IndusInd Bank, Sundaram BNP Paribas, and of course, Deloitte for being our consultants for this. I would like to thank the members of the media, our distinguished past presidents who continue to be the guiding light for MMA, invitees, members of MMA, Mr. Ram Kumar, President MMA, members of the Managing Committee, of course, our secretariat headed by Group Captain Vijay Kumar for his absolutely fantastic coordination in making this event a success. And of course, Padmaja, for your excellent invocation. Thank you all very much, and please join us for dinner.
Kindly be seated, ladies and gentlemen. We have the AGM commencing shortly. Before that, we would also like to honor the jury members for the MAM process. May I request Mr. Swami to kindly come on to the stage to receive the memento. Mr. Swami, if you could kindly come onto the stage to receive the award.
Gracias.